All right, guys. So this is that beautiful 1982 240D that I just did the walk around video for after coming back from the detail shop. Sorry, I've got the camera on a stand. It was kind of crooked. But the car actually just sold. So before it goes out of the shop, though, I told the new owner that I want to do a valve adjustment because I hadn't had a chance to do a valve adjustment on it yet. So this is just a quick video showing a valve adjustment. So what I've already done is popped off the linkage for the throttle and cruise control. That way I can get in here to access everything. And we'll just pop off this linkage here. Lay that over here, and this is actually, here's the vacuum box on top. This linkage actually, it goes under the tab for the vacuum box. Okay, that's better. So I took the two bolts off here. This linkage here, this is your cruise control linkage. This is under the vacuum box there. So I'll take that off. Now we're going to pop off this main throttle linkage right here, like that. And then we're going to pop off that linkage there. There we go. And now this can slip out. I'll just go ahead and slip that out of here. And this vacuum, the vacuum lines can go out of the way. And we're just going to fold that over. Right there, remove the valve cover. There we go, move that right there like that. Disconnect this linkage right here. So we'll pull that one off. And we'll pull that one off there. But there's a little C-clip right here. We want to pull that off. We got it off without dropping it. Sucks to drop those things. Now we can pull that assembly out of there like that. We'll just set everything right there. Now we can pop off our valve cover. And they're only torqued to like... There we go. Valve lash at water temp below 30 degrees says the intake is 0.1 millimeter and the exhaust is 0.3 or 0.10 millimeters and 0.30 millimeters. That's on a cold engine. You can see here it gives you the hot engine 0.15 and 0.35. So we're on a cold engine. We're going to do 0.10 and 0.30. And 0.30 millimeters. I don't know if you guys can be able to see that. There we go. Is the same as 12 thousandths. So this feeler gauge should slip right in here. And it does not. It is too tight because these valves need to be adjusted because they tighten up when they go out of adjustment. All right, guys, that's about as good as I'm going to be able to do. You see, there is the adjustment nut and the lock nut right there. Here's the wrenches. Once we get the top nut set where we want it, the bottom nut actually, that's the one you tighten up. So the top nut is your lash. The bottom nut is your basically your set screw or your set your tightening set nut. That means we want to tighten the nut on the top. We tightened it just a little bit, and let's see what we got. Still, it's still too tight. Let's get our wrenches in here, come down some more. There we go. Boom. Just a snug. Just want it snug. So we can tighten up this bottom nut now. It's a dance with the wrenches. There we go. Perfect. That is the perfect adjustment. So the next one that's really in place to be adjusted next is the intake on cylinder 2. See, it's almost all the way up. So I'm going to go ahead and check off that we did number 1, exhaust. Put a check. And now we're going to go to the intake. So I'm just going to rotate the engine. And we're going to get this lobe straight up. There we go. That lobe is vertical. And that is the intake. You know, a good way to tell it's the intake? Because there's some intake runners right there. See there? Let me zoom out. There's the air cleaner. See the intake runners? Well, that intake runner runs right into here. There you go. There's the intake. So you can see this runner here is for that intake. That runner there is for that intake. There's the exhaust manifold. There's the exhaust valve. See how everything kind of lines up? Here's an exhaust manifold. That's an exhaust valve. So anyway, we'll adjust this intake. And our instructions tell us that that needs to be 0.1 millimeters. 0.004 or 4 thousandths is the same as 0.10 millimeters. The intake on cylinder 2. All right, the next one that looks about ready is, looks like we could do the intake on cylinder 1. On cylinder 1, the second valve is the intake. So what's that need to be? 0.10 millimeters or 4 thousandths. So, yeah, feels good. We'll just check 13. 13 does not go in. So our intake. So I think typically what I've noticed is exhausts often need adjusted, but intakes don't. Because the exhaust valve is off, obviously running a lot hotter. Hot exhaust gas is coming through there, so maybe that has an effect on the valve lash over time. It looks like, there we go, this one. So that is cylinder 3, and that is the exhaust valve. There we go, right there, perfectly vertical. So we're going to check that. Yep. Same thing. That one is too tight. All right, we need to loosen that up a little bit. Guys, and there's a feel for this. Once you get the feel, there you go. That's perfect. Once you get the feel, it is not difficult. It takes a few times of doing it before you kind of feel what exactly it is you're doing. I helped take that air cleaner off, but I am not going to do that. All right, that feels really good. I'm just going to go ahead and check the next level up to make sure, which is 0.33 millimeters. Oh, 0.33 goes in there. So that tells me I'm a little on the loose side. And it's better to be on the loose side than the tight side, because like I said, they tighten up when the adjustment goes out. So I'm going to actually tighten this one up a little bit. Yeah, I think that's going to do it. Check one more time with the... All right. My girlfriend that just pulled up in her 98 E300. I'm just making this a little tighter. I didn't like how that felt. It was a little loose. Yeah, I'd say we're good on that. All right. So we're in the exhaust, cylinder 4. I'm guessing it's going to be tight like the other ones. Let's go ahead and check it. Yeah, it's tight for sure. So to make that looser, we need to tighten the bottom nut to spin it further down on the valve stem, and then screw the top nut down a little further. All right, that was a pretty significant adjustment there. Let's see what that did. 30 thousandths. Oh, perfect. That is a perfect valve lash. Now let's just tighten it back up. So we want to hold our top nut still while making the bottom nut go counterclockwise. Perfect. This is the one we're doing now. So we're on cylinder 3 exhaust. I'm sorry, cylinder 2 exhaust. 1, 2, 3, 4. And this one is, it was tight, just like the other exhausts. All right, exhaust cylinder 2 is done. Now we got one more. Yep, that's perfect. We don't need to make an adjustment. So there we go. Valve adjustment is now done on this engine. All of the exhausts were too tight and we loosened them up. So that'll help a lot of things. The engine will run smoother. It'll crank up a little easier when it's cold. Probably get a little bit better fuel mileage. That's just, you know, the correct settings. So I'm gonna get this valve cover back on here now and a new valve cover gasket. All right, now that we've finished the valve adjustment, we've got a new valve cover gasket. And we're just going to put this back on the engine. Sometimes they fall right in place and sometimes you got to fight with them. The trick is making sure your gasket doesn't come off. Go. Boom, that one went on there without too much fight. Now you check around after you put it on and you make sure the gasket didn't pop loose and peel back anywhere. Sometimes it likes to do it around the back of the engine. But that looks good to me. Setting all our linkages back on the engine. And
and we'll just put a couple of bolts in there to get everything started. Now keep in mind, these are this is aluminum valve cover, so you do not torque these down. There you go. See that little bolt right under there? You got to run it down a little bit so then you can move the throttle linkage over it to get that one in. All right, there you go. See, you got to move. See, the throttle linkage is blocking that hole there. So you got to run that one in first, then move the throttle linkage, and then you can get access to that one. Snug that one up. I need to put my snap ring around the end right here.
Pretty cool.
All right, guys, now I'm installing the this little snap ring. Let's see, there it is. Back on the front of the throttle linkage here. And I really, really want to do it without dropping it. Because when you drop these, they're just kind of gone forever. So we'll see if I can get it on there. Oh, got it. All right, good. This is like a spring-loaded retainer I've got to install back around the throttle linkage back here. So we'll do that now. You guys saw me take apart all the linkage. So I didn't record really putting the rest back together. I think last thing you saw, I had to put the snap ring on there, which I did. And then I just brought up the idle circuit, bolted that on there. Now I want the idle to be increased a little bit. So this is one of the levers that goes over to the cruise control. And you can see I've shortened it. And that's gonna pull our throttle up a little bit and increase the idle a little bit. So I wanna see if that makes a big difference. But the valve adjustment is done. I'm just trying to grab a couple of 100 RPMs on the idle. So let me crank it up here. That's much better, isn't it? That's too much. That's pretty much, that's perfect, isn't it? Nice. So look how smooth that's idling, you guys. See, there's not even a vibration on the engine. So basically, in order to grab a couple of hundred more RPMs, I just shortened this linkage just a little bit, and it pulls your throttle linkage, see? But yeah, I'm really happy with that. Now what we want to do is just look around the back of the engine, and we want to look for any leaks in that valve cover, because we just put it back on there. So I'm going to just go around and do that inspection real quick. Back here is where they tend to leak if you're going to have a leak, but we're looking good. And I'm really happy with the idle now, too. So mission accomplished. Also, the vacuum system is real healthy. You saw how quick the engine shut off. It should shut off within 1 to 2 seconds of turning that key. And that shut off almost immediately. So it's got a very healthy vacuum system. All right, next I noticed this car has the
the crappy aftermarket diesel return hose. So I'm just going to get in here and pull this stuff off and put on some genuine Mercedes hose, because this stuff always leaks. Well, it just doesn't last a long time. There we go. So let me show you guys this. You can actually see how wet that is. That's because it's seeping through the rubber. These are terrible, guys. Anytime you see them on your car, it's tempting to buy them because they're much cheaper. I mean, we're talking $5 or $10. We're not talking about a huge difference, but the Mercedes stuff, which is right here, this stuff will last you years, and this is really good quality. So I'm going to go ahead and replace all those. No need to record that. You guys have seen that before. All right, guys, I've done the valve adjustment, adjusted the throttle linkage, and put on new diesel return lines. You can see the engine is cold. Still got the protective wrap from the detail shop on the steering wheel, but and I'm just going to go ahead and fire it up. You can see how quick this engine comes to life here. Got good glow plugs. There we go. We got good oil pressure. Now I want to go take a look at if any of those injector lines are leaking. I'll replace the plug in the back, and we've got all Mercedes injector lines, return lines. None of that's leaking. We've got good idle, the valve's adjusted, and the valve cover gasket not leaking, and throttle linkage adjusted. But so we're good. All right, so the next thing I need to do is put this R12 AC system. I need to put it under vacuum, check the condition of it. Let me just take a look. All right, you know what? I'm also gonna change the pre-filter here. See, the pre-filter is dirty. I'm gonna go ahead and put in a fresh pre-filter. And someone has already put on a Moly main filter, so I'll just go ahead and change this one. And I can also see that the primer pump has already been replaced. Super clean down there. You know what? Man, that looks like the Bosch injection lift pump. That looks like a new one. It's so clean. Anyway, I'm going to change that. But next thing I want to do is put the AC system on the vacuum. All right, guys. This old 240D still has the R12 system in it. And looks good. Hasn't been tampered with or opened up. And so I'm going to go ahead and pull a vacuum on it. And you can see we're currently pulling the vacuum at negative 30. And I'm going to seal this up, turn off the vacuum pump, and we're going to see, let's just sit here for several hours and see if it holds that vacuum. That'll let us know if there's any major leaks. And if not, we will go ahead and recharge it with R12. There's a big canister R12. This car, see right here, R12 max for the 123 chassis is 2.6 pounds. So we'll put a canister on a scale. There's just a regular old scale. I use a bathroom scale because that thing is 30 pounds, 35 pounds, and this will accurately read that. If you try to use like one of those packing scales, that's too much weight for it. And this goes down to, you know, the 0.123, you know, of an ounce. So that works well. So I'm going to go ahead and seal this off, and let's see if this thing holds a vacuum. Let's turn off our vacuum pump. And there we go. We're looking right down here. We are at negative 30. And we want to see if that holds. Because if it drops down, that means there's a leak in the system. So we're going to let that sit there for a few hours, come back and check on it. All right, here we are about an hour later on the 240D, still holding vacuum. So far, no leaks. We're going to leave it on there for another hour, and then we're going to apply vacuum for about 45 minutes to get any moisture out of the system. And then we'll put in some oil and some R12 and get this thing back up and running. All right, guys, it's been 2 hours, and we are still, see, there's the zero mark. We're down here at like negative 28, negative 30, something like that. So this is definitely holding a vacuum. So I don't think we got any leaks here. So I'm going to go ahead, turn back on the vacuum pump, and then we're going to open back up our valve. And we're going to pull a vacuum for about 45 minutes and just make sure the system is good and dry. When you pull a vacuum, any kind of moisture or water will evaporate out of the system. We'll do that for about 45 minutes, and when it's done, we will recharge the system. 32.7, and we want 2.6 pounds. So 30.1, is we want this to be at 30.1. All right, guys, we got a, I'm gonna take this thing off. Okay, so we got to get this thing fired up and the AC turned on. Our AC on max. Turn our blower on. Everything's on cold here. Got our blower on high. All right, let's go charge this system. And there we go. Our R12 was flowing in. Let's listen for the compressor to kick on. There it goes. Compressor just kicked on. And the system is definitely charging. See how our AC feels now. Oh yeah, ice cold. Ice cold AC. Compressor's working, we got ice cold. So let's go get some oil in the system. We wanted to be about 30.1. We're at 29.9, so we got like 0.2 of an ounce over, which is fine. That's pretty damn close. Now, let's go ahead. We want to put in I'm going to put in some ester oil. It's better for the seals than the PAG. Add 1 ounce of oil. And you apply this the same way as we did the R12. We'll have to get the air out of this little line here. The way you apply it, we actually crank this canister. Now that's going to push any air out of the line. Now you can see there's actual oil in our gauge here. I don't know if you guys can see that. Let's see. There you go. See the little bubble at the top? That's oil inside there. Up our valve, and we will pump in our oil. Close the line. Oh yeah, that is ice cold. Outstanding. And we check our climate control, the AC correctly turned off. good. There's no AC. Let's put it back on. The condenser just turned back on. And we have ice cold air.
All right, you guys, we're gonna go out for a test drive in this 240D. We got the AC working, and I wanna test out the cruise control too. Probably have to replace that module, not sure yet. AC works great. You can see the little condensation starting to form up on the window. Let me actually turn it down some. There we go. So I'm gonna just hold the camera and drive the stick and steer with one hand. With these manual 240Ds, they're very fun because you can just bang through the gears and just floor it. There we go, we're in fourth, just cruising. See if this cruise control works. So no, the cruise control does not work, so I'm gonna have to get a replacement cruise control module, which is very easy. It's actually right behind that plastic kick panel, and on this car it's actually bolted, connected to the kick panel. So you just fold down the kick panel, pop it out, and put another one in. But as far as the driving and the AC and everything else, that cruise control is the last item. These 240Ds are so much fun. This downshift up here around this turn. Now we're in second. I'm shifting with one hand and steering with that same hand, so I'm having to like grab the shifter real quick and go back and forth so I can hold the camera. We'll downshift here again and hang a right. We're in second now. All right, let's get our floor here. There we go. Go back into third. These are so much fun. I mean, it's not that slow, to be honest with you. I'm in fourth gear. It just took me, I'm already about up to 55. I'm slowing down because we're not supposed to be going 55 on this road. But yeah, the four speed makes these cars fun. The automatics, forget about it. They're so slow, it's terrible. But the four speeds make it great. Look at that turning radius. Here we go, here's some 0 to 60. 25. 40, I'm in third gear. Fourth gear. 55, there we go. I have to slow down, there's a light coming up. So there you go, there's your 0 to 60 in a 240D. Not so bad. Sure is fun though. Let's see. Go back down to first here. And the shifter is super long throw. Look how far that shifter goes. That's awesome. All right. And when you start out, you just floor the gas pedal. I've got one hand, so I can't shift in a corner. There we go. If there's not too much traffic here, we may be able to do another 0 to 60. I'm gonna put it back in the first here.
You know, this is the same size car as a 300D, but it feels so much more agile. Like, it feels way more nimble. There's something about the four-speed that changes the total, that completely changes the vibe. It makes the car feel more smaller and more agile. It's kind of strange, because I think it's the exact same dimensions as the 300D. It's 123, same car. But you throw in that four-speed, and you feel like you're in a smaller car. It's kind of a cool feeling. So yeah, replace that cruise control module, and that'll wrap things up on this 1982 240D. And hope you enjoyed the series on this car. And stay tuned, and we'll have another series out. The next one's on an 82 300D with 68,000 miles. I think I released a video the other day. Anyway, take care, you guys. Thanks for watching. All right, guys, I'm actually going to show you how easy it is to change the cruise control module on a 240D. You pop out these little clips here. All right, once that's out, there we go. The cruise control module is right there. There we go. Pull off that connector. All right. I just lowered this panel here. And you literally take this screw out right here. There we go, guys. So there's a screw on the front side and a screw on the back side. And you can see... See, there's where they mount into, here and here. And this little contraption goes right there. So here is our cruise control module. And I will send this off. I have a guy that repairs any kind of circuit boards for me, including these cruise control module. But there's the part number. And I actually have some coming back from him tomorrow. He might have an 82 that he sent me back. So if the part numbers are the same, I'll just pop that in here. And we have this cruise control back in working condition. Anyway, thanks for watching. See you guys next time.